Montreal, 1976, the 5,000 metres. This was the race Murray Helberg had won in Rome 16 years earlier. Here in Canada, it was to produce one of the most famous and dramatic finishes of all time. With the Africans out, it was another all-white affair, but there were two men wearing the famous black singlet in the race, Rod Dixon and Dick Quax.
I went into the Olympics with a 13-13, just outside the world record. I'd beaten everybody prior to the Olympics that I'd come up against. So in that respect, I sort of felt, well, whatever happens, I've got a good chance of winning it anyway, whether the African's there or not.
I felt confident going into the final that no one's going to really go out there and break it wide open. If anybody does, it would probably be Brendan Foster, and his was the sort of pace that suited me. So as the laps ticked off, I became more confident in my own ability.
Well, the tension must be rising amongst these runners, and it's under these conditions that you can get somebody make a very fast move. Adrenaline starting to pour through their bodies, and they wonder who's going to make it.
Viren moved up ominously there. Dixon and Quax have gone with him.
Also running in the blue singlet, the defending Olympic champion Lasse Viren from Finland, who only days earlier won his third Olympic gold in the 10,000 metres. Viren was again favourite, but would be under pressure if it came to a sprint finish.
I knew I was in good condition, but of course it's always difficult to go into a race as a favourite. Of course, there are certain kinds of pressures, but on the other hand, there is nothing much to lose. It would be no great loss if you don't win there because you already have Olympic wins behind you. It's easier. The pressure is not so intense as it would otherwise be.
Somebody must make a move shortly.
Hildebrand moved out, Viren has gone, Dixon lopes along there.
My number one plan was for the others to do the work. But as no one was prepared to lead, I had to revert to my second plan, which was to take control, which I did, and everything went to plan.
Lap and a half to go. Things have warmed up, but if the medals are being handed out, they'll probably go to these six.
Slowly and surely, people were starting to drop off. And so when we hit the last lap, Viren was leading, the two Brits, Stewart and Foster, were there. A little Portuguese guy was there. Rod Dixon was right up there. And I think I was in about fifth or sixth place at the time.
This is the last lap. At the end of this lap, they'll hand out the gold, the silver and the bronze. And New Zealand has a chance with Dixon line third, Quax in fifth. Hildebrand is going first. 200 metres out. Viren, Hildebrand, Dixon. Quax line fourth.
The Kiwis had blown it. Quax, the silver medal. Dixon confirmed in fourth place. They had the speed, they didn't have the tactics.
It was supposed to be the mile runner's race. If it's hanging on the last lap, Dixon and Quax and Hildebrand, who came third, in principle, everyone was quicker, or should have been quicker than I was. And that was one thought, that the result should have been decided before the last lap. But luckily, nobody tried it.
When I passed that 250 mark and I wasn't in control, I think I started to feel a bit uncomfortable, and yet in front of me was Viren, who had about a 5 second 800 meters slower than me, I felt comfortable that I could hold Quax. Hildebrand was looming up on the outside, but I felt that that was just a surge. And really, from that point on, it started to go wrong for me.
I picked up the two Brits, I picked up the Portuguese guy, and on the bend, I went around Rod, and I went around Hildebrand, and so there was still four of us at 120 metres to go, all still battling it out. And I slightly edged in front of Viren, and I thought, I've got everybody, I've got this race won. And for one instance, through my mind went the thought, I'm the Olympic champion.
And I got into lane three and tried to take them all around the turn. And as I came up the home straight, the old bear got me. It jumped right on my back and I was carrying it. And I realized that as I was starting to tire, I was starting to go backwards.
Not only was there no gold medal for Dixon, he soon learned there was no medal at all.
I felt sure that the bronze was mine because you've got that 190 vision, you see, and there's no one looming up, and so you know that my nose is still ahead. And then right on the line, I saw this flash. And I think there was some consideration given to the fact that he didn't go across the finish line a metre above. But I said, no, I mean, he got there.
To be in fourth place is probably the worst place that you can be at the Olympics, you know. You miss out on a medal, you've run very well, but, you know, no cigar.
I knew what I'd done wrong, and I gathered up my bag, put my training shoes on and ran right back to the village and ran up the 15 stories to my room and stood there, and I cried, of course. I was devastated. It was a point in my life which it was completely blown apart.
Dick Quax did get a medal, but not the one he wanted.
I was bitterly disappointed. It was so close, it could have been a gold medal. But I don't have now, all these years later, with the benefit of hindsight, I don't have any regrets at all.
Now that the race was over and lost, Rod Dixon had an even bigger challenge.
In a sense, you know, that was a time of total devastation. But I realised that I only really had two options. And one of them was to get up and continue to compete.
Because of the boycott of the 1980 Moscow Olympic Games, Rod Dixon was denied the next opportunity to make good in the Olympic arena. But in 1983, 7 years after Montreal, there came a moment, and what a moment it was. The New York Marathon. This was to provide Rod Dixon's gold medal.
My finish wasn't rehearsed. It wasn't. It just was spontaneous. It was just, I knew as I fell to my knees and crisped the ground that there was something from 1976 that I had just got rid of. And yeah, it would have been nice to have done that race in the Olympics. But sometimes, as we know, swimmers come and go between Olympics. Great performances are not necessarily done at the Olympics. You take the opportunity when you can. And that was what I consider the almost perfect race. The way it was done, the way I ran it, that was the pinnacle of my life. It was the icing on the cake.
Rod Dixon had one more bite at the Olympic cake. Next year, he went to the 1984 Los Angeles Games and finished 10th in the marathon. The decision was especially sweet for Rod Dixon, who long held dreams of Olympic gold. Now he was lining up to compete in the footsteps of Lovelock and Snell in the final of that very New Zealand event, the 1500 metres. Also running, fellow Kiwi Tony Polehill. But the man everyone was watching was the defending Olympic champion, Kipkeno of Kenya.
As the gun went, I knew instinctively that I had to watch and wait for Kino, because he was the runner who was more than likely to run the race which best suited me. And when Kino moved, I moved. I didn't expect Vasile to be there quite so early.
Kino starting to keep that pressure on. 2:42 at the bell. Vasile second, Dixon moving through, outside of Foster. Boyd makes his move. Kano, beautiful runner.
Boyd third, Dixon fourth.
I knew I was fourth place, but I still believed that I was going to pick up Boyd off the turn, which I did.
Dixon's in with a chance of a medal.
And then I started to believe that I could actually catch Kaino, and I actually was catching him. But by the time we went across the finish line, I mean, it was all hell. It was just amazing.
Masala, Kaino, and a bronze medal for New Zealand. The bronze medal, Rod Dixon, New Zealand.
That was the beginning of knowing that this is what I want in life.
Dixon with three great runs. Can he believe it? I think perhaps not.
2 years later in Christchurch at the 1974 Commonwealth Games, Dixon lined up again for the 1500 metres final. Boyd was there, but so too was another young Kiwi, John Walker. The race, of course, went to Filbert Bay of Tanzania. Dixon was out of the medals, consigned to fourth. All Kiwi eyes were now on Walker, who finished second. Dixon looked to a new event and found immediate success in the 5,000 metres.
So I was ranked number one in the world for 5,000 in 1975. And I may point out at this point that I moved to the 5,000 because I recognised that John Walker had far more potential than I did. And it's this sort of, you have to move out as the young ones come in. So the 5,000 seemed to be natural.
Montreal, Canada. In 1976, the New Zealand Olympic team walked into a cauldron of controversy. A boycott of the games over a New Zealand rugby tour of South Africa. Hundreds of athletes from more than 20 countries withdrew. The reaction to the Kiwis in Canada was outrage. They were placed under heavy guard the moment they arrived. Millions of television viewers around the world to see his running shoes being worn by the high-profile Kiwi runners, and indeed they did. John Walker, of course, won the 1500 metres gold medal in his Adidas shoes. Dassler had enormous influence with the powerful Eastern European teams. Walker says if the Kiwis were expelled, Dassler threatened to withdraw his sponsorship money from the Eastern Europeans. Walker says the prospect of losing all that Adidas money convinced the East Europeans to sacrifice the Africans in favour of New Zealand.
If we'd been Puma athletes, I think we would have been boycotted and we would have been out of the Olympics as well.
New Zealand would have been out of the Olympics in 76.
I'm absolutely convinced of it. And I'm sure that the only reason we were saved was because those three were chances of winning gold medals and that we were Adidas athletes.
So the Africans went home, the New Zealanders stayed, and along with Walker, Dixon and Quax were to give even more exposure to the footwear in one of the classic Olympic showdowns.